morning, everyone. We'd like to welcome you to Live Spring Church today. If it's your first visit with us, you are our honored guest. We thank you for being here. You can text the word on your cell phone, the word welcome, to 972-402-6456. And we'd like you to connect with us. We've got a great spiritual family here. Or you can reach in front of your chair. There is a connect card. And if you don't mind filling that out, bringing it back to the sound booth or one of the buckets in the back, we would appreciate it. I want to pray a blessing over you this morning. How many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord? Man, I'm excited about today. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we're so excited to be in your presence. And we thank you for all the people that are watching online right now, God. And we just send our prayers digitally out to them as well. And we just pray a blessing over everyone watching, everyone here today. Lord, your word declares that in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And we're just honored to experience it with you today. We thank you and praise you and give you all the glory in Jesus' name.
Let's all put our hands together this morning as we praise God.
Sometimes on this journey, I can get lost in my mistakes. It looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And the story isn't over, my story's just begun. And failure won't define me, that's what my father does. No, failure won't define me, that's what my father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, get in the Father's house. Check your shame out the door. It ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. I was not the end game. The journey's where you are. Never wanted perfect, just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. Failures never find hope when the Father's in the room. Failures never find hope when the Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burden.
Sing it out.
Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, Father's house. Check your shame at the door. Sin ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door.
Father, we thank you that in your house, your presence is here, your joy is here, Father, that prodigals get to come home, Father, and that prison doors fling wide, Father. Everything is open this morning, Father. We pray that we would choose to open up our hearts to you, and we would choose to open up our minds to you, open up our ears, open our eyes, Father. We want to magnify you in everything we do, Father. We want to make you bigger, not our problem, not our situation, but you, Father. We worship you. We praise you. It's all about you, Father. It's all about you. Come on, let's sing this together. We're creation.
And we're creation, suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we hear Christ be magnified. And with the whole earth echoing his evidence, his name would burst from sea. From rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, we bless your name, oh yes. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise, and Christ be magnified.
Worship whatever comes. And I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join. Your love was greater.
mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Hey, greet somebody with an air high five or an air fist bump or just give them a hug. We don't care. God bless you this morning as you're seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Man, I don't know about you, but I feel the joy. I feel the presence of God in a mighty way, and it's just exciting. The highlight of my week is to come here and be with my spiritual family and just love on God and say hi to everybody, and it's just great. We love God and love people here. Hey, we are going to continue in our series called The Signs of the Times. How many of you, I just sense there's a real interest in what you're seeing in the news and seeing that it's already spoken about in the Bible and how we can apply some of these things to our lives. So I thought my dad did a wonderful job last week in his message. I appreciate him. I consider him one of the experts on this, and we have some more in the future. I've just confirmed with two other guest speakers that are coming in this series. And you may have a question. If you have a question, you can always come up and ask us afterwards, or you can put it in your cell phone or write it in your notes, and we're going to have a Q&A. We're going to have an end times Q&A coming up. I believe that is November 16th. Let me check that real quick. Actually, it's November 15th is the Sunday. If you come on November 16th, we will have a great men and women's meeting fellowship here, but that's our small group on it. But November 15th, yeah, we'll have a Q&A. So we'll have a panel of experts up here to field your questions about the end times. But hey, let's go to why do we want to study about the end times? Why should we study? Why should we learn about the end times? Why is it so important? Well, first of all, it's because we're here. You know, in the past, and I would hear preachers growing up saying, we're here, and you know, you kind of, but we're here. How many of you know? We're looking over the edge of the end times right now with everything that's going on. So let's look at what the Bible says, though, in Revelation 1:1-3. And I'm going to share today some secrets with you that I hope will bless you. But the question is, why should we study the end times? Well, Revelation 1:1-3 says this about, in the Amplified, it says, this is, and this is, people get tripped up on the book of Revelation, but if you understand this phrase, you'll understand the book of Revelation. This is the revelation or the unveiling or the revealing of Jesus Christ. So this book of Revelation is about Jesus Christ. In fact, you can see the theme of Jesus Christ in every book in the Bible. But this one specifically says this is about the revelation of Jesus Christ, his unveiling of the divine mysteries which God the Father gave to him to show his bondservants or believers the things which must soon take place in their entirety. And this is an important thing you have to understand. He sent and communicated it. That word communicated in the Amplified is the word Simeon in the Greek. And it means that he gave it in symbolic language. Here's John. And by the way, John is the apostle that was closest to Jesus. He was the only one of the men that were there at the cross. There were some ladies there. Aren't you thankful for ladies? Amen. Through thick and thin. But there was one man there. All the other disciples betrayed him, deserted him, sold him out. But there was one, and it was John. John also took care of Jesus' mother after the cross, Mary. And John was exiled to an island called Patmos. You can still go to Patmos if you sail in the Mediterranean and find that island. But that's where they sent him after they had tried to boil him alive, by the way. He just wouldn't die. Kind of like the Dallas Stars. They just won't die, right? Anyway, sidetrack. But he was sent to the island of Patmos, and God gave him these visions. And you have to understand, when you read in the book of Revelation, when he says, I saw a horse's face with the sounds of chariots marching and the sting of a scorpion's tail. When you read that, he's describing a helicopter. But they didn't have the word helicopter. The helicopter wasn't invented. So you get the symbolic terminology that comes through Revelation of the best way he could describe it in that time. Are you with me so far? I'm gonna try to make this simple, but this is very deep truth I'm about to share. Okay? So it says he symbolized it, or he communicated it by his angel, divine messenger, to his bondservant John, who testified and gave supporting evidence to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to everything he saw in his visions. Now, this is a promise for you. How many of you are thankful that God gives us a series of promises in his words that we can latch onto and have hope? And this is one of them. He says, blessed or happy, prosperous, to be admired is he who reads and those who hear the words and of this prophecy and who keep. Now, this is a good way to study the Bible, period. But especially the book of Revelation. Read the Bible, hear or understand in your spirit, and then apply them to your life. You can do that with any of the scriptures, but he says if you do that specifically with the end times prophetic book of Revelation, then there's an extra blessing in there for you. So I don't know about you, but anytime the Bible says, blessed is he, my ears perk up. Like, oh God, I want your blessing on my life. You know, if there's two choices, I want the blessing, right? So it says who keeps the things, and then it goes on to say which are written in it, heeding them and taking them to heart, for the time of fulfillment is near. So I'm going to share with you this morning four ways or four views how we can interpret this book. And before I share, let me have a couple of volunteers. Who wants to volunteer? Come on up here, Michael. Let's have Matthew. Doyle, you come on up too. I'm going to illustrate something to you because this is what happens. I want you to understand. Y'all come on up here on the stage so people can see you, okay? How about giving these men a big hand of praise? All right. In the Bible, I want you to picture a target in your mind. The bullseye of the target is absolute truths. The Bible is nothing but absolute truth. But there are absolute, like Jesus is the Son of God. There's no argument there. There's no interpretation there. Jesus was born of a virgin. There are absolute, that there's no argument. Now, then the next outer ring is interpretation, depending on how you interpret the scripture. Is Jesus coming before the tribulation, after the tribulation? Well, that depends on how you look at it and how you view it. All those kind of things, right? Never, ever get offended or hung up or mad or in an argument with anybody because of interpretation. I'm going to share you four ways. Now, the absolute truths, that's your core values. You got to hold to that. And that should never be challenged. We're Christians. We believe in the Bible, the absolute truth. But I'm going to show you an example of this. I want you gentlemen up here. I'm going to say a word, and I want you to tell me what you're thinking about. Okay? And audience, the word is trunk. Michael, what'd you picture?
Elephant trunk.
An elephant trunk. Matthew, what'd you picture?
Car trunk.
A car trunk.
Elephant trunk.
Somebody else may have pictured a trunk of a tree. Somebody else may be science, medical, the trunk, the abdomen. Now, who's right? He is. But you'd be surprised about how many believers can get that way. No, there's only one way to interpret Revelation, and it's my way. All y'all else are wrong. You can't be dogmatic on that. Because Revelation was written in a way that I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you four different ways to interpret it. It's still the truth. But I want you to ask God, speak to my heart, and teach me these things and share with me because he's right, trunk, he's right, trunk, and he's right, trunk. And some of you that had other opinions are right. But it's just your interpretation of the word trunk. Are you with me this morning? Let's give these gentlemen a good hand of praise. Thank you this morning, guys. All right. So with that in mind, let's look at these four views. And I'm going to throw out some big words, but just I'll explain them so you understand what they are. The first way to interpret, and by the way, I should mention that this is a very good resource. If you get a chance to get this, or you can get this, maybe the software or whatever. But it's called Revelation, Four Views, a Parallel Commentary. So what it is, this is normally the size of a Bible, right? This is just the book of Revelation. But in it, there is four columns. And one of them is one view interpretation, another interpretation, another interpretation, another interpretation, every single word in the book of Revelation. So if you want to get this first one, the historicist is the first one I'm going to mention. The historicist is a belief that the book of Revelation is a whole survey of history. Okay? So let me tell you something about history. History has already been done, right? But history is still being made, right? We've got a historical election coming up, don't you? History is still being written. So history is not just in the past. I need you to understand. And the historicist viewpoint of Revelation is the viewpoint that, yes, everything already happened, but yes, some things are still happening. And history is still to be written. Okay, so let me give you an example of this. Let's look at Revelation 12, and let's see if you'll catch on. These nine verses in here, I'm going to read them, and see if you can catch on and you think of something that already happened in the past and is happening. Because John, in the book of Revelation, jumps around in the timeline. Revelation is not written in chronological order. I need you to understand. John had these visions, and his vision would be of the past. And I'm going to read you a scripture that Jesus Christ, the revelation of Jesus Christ, is who was the past, who is the present, and who is to come, the future. That's Jesus Christ. So aren't you thankful that God, the God that we serve, is bigger than time? And time can't encapsulate Jesus Christ. So this says, John's vision. I witnessed in heaven an event of great significance. I saw a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon beneath her feet, and the crown of 12 stars on her head. Now, this could be interpreted, the woman, as Israel. Israel had 12 tribes, the crown of stars. It can also be interpreted in another way as the church, the bride of Christ. Anytime you see a woman in the Bible, you can also interpret it as the bride of Christ. Okay, so it says she was pregnant. Now follow this along here. And she cried out because of her labor pains to the agony of giving birth. Then I witnessed in heaven another significant event. I saw, now, so he's talking about this lady here. Now this is another event, but they're going to tie together. A large red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, do you believe that's being literal? That John is, that there's actually going to be a large red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns that comes out of the ocean and rules the earth? No, it's symbolic. It represents something. So, and it's the enemy. The 7 crowns on his heads, his tail swept away 1/3 of the stars in the sky and threw them to the earth. Now it's about to interpret what that was. He stood in front of the woman as she was about to give birth, ready to devour her, the dragon, and the baby as soon as it was born. But she gave birth to the son. The church, Israel, gave birth to Jesus Christ, who was to rule all nations with an iron rod. And her child was snatched away from the dragon, thank God. Do you remember when, and was caught up to God and to his throne? How did Jesus leave the earth? He ascended up on the clouds. That's what it's referring to, I believe. And then it goes on, and the woman fled into the wilderness. Now, this is a different part of the vision here, where God had prepared a place to care for her for 1,260 days. That's 3.5 years, roughly, and it represents a part of the tribulation. Now you're going forward. There was a war in heaven. Now you're going backwards. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and remember 1/3 of the stars with his tails? The dragon lost the battle, and he and his angels were forced out of heaven. The great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, the one deceiving the whole earth, the whole world, was thrown down to the earth with all his angels. Now, I believe in a historical belief in this would be that that already happened. And you know the story that Lucifer got pride and Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning, and he took 1/3 of all the angels with him. Remember that story? Now, there another belief, another interpretation would believe, well, this hasn't happened yet, but it's going to happen. So, depending on how you interpret it. But that's just a historical view of that. Now, let's look at a second way to interpret. This is a big word, but don't get caught up in this word. It's called preterist. If you don't like the word preterist, just think of a time in our calendar, A.D. 70. Long time ago. A.D. 70. This belief or this interpretation of Revelation believes that shortly after Revelation was written or about the time, everything was fulfilled. Okay? Now I'm going to give you what I believe is an example that could be interpreted that way. And then next week, I'm going to share this same scripture and view another interpretation. Why am I doing this? Because I want you to pray. I want you to decide. I want you to, for God to speak to you. And don't just take your pastor's word for it. You read this, you study this, you get the blessing of this, and you come up with your own belief system, okay? I'm not going to tell you how to believe. I'm not going to tell you how to live, all that kind of stuff. That's up to you, right? Okay, so Revelation 6, 1 through 10 says this. As I watched, here's a vision again, the Lamb, Jesus, broke the first of the seven seals. Now, in the book of Revelation, there are seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls that John sees in this vision. So we're talking about the first part, the seals that were broken, like if you opened up a scroll and there was a wax seal. And so he broke the first one, and I heard one of the four living beings say with a voice like thunder, come. I looked up and I saw a white horse standing there. A rider carried a bow, and a crown was placed on his head. He rode out to win many battles and gain the victory. Now, at first glance, you may think, wait a minute. I read somewhere that Jesus is coming back on a white horse. Is this Jesus? No. This is actually, I believe, and I'll share this next week, the Antichrist. Because the Bible says that that authority, God gave authority to the Antichrist. He gives authority. He gives authority to every believer, though, by the way, to trample on serpents and scorpions, the Bible says. And that's not a literal, that we're not snake handling. What that means is we have the power over the enemy. Amen? And the white horse that Jesus is coming back, the Bible says that he has a crown, but he's not carrying a bow. He has a sword, a two-edged sword that comes out of his mouth, John saw the video. This one is a guy with a bow and so God gives the Antichrist a little authority to comment. And what you say, why would he do that? Well, why would God give Pharaoh authority over the children of Israel? Why would God give Pilate authority to crucify Jesus? You know, so on and so on. God has used and always will use the enemy's bad plans and make something great about it. Aren't you glad that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was crucified and died for our sins and our mistakes so that we could reap the rewards of eternal life? See, so God turned an evil plan and the authority that they had and made something great out of it. So, then it says, so that's the conquering horse, a little bit of authority, the Antichrist. Then it says, when the Lamb broke the second seal, I heard the second living being say, come. Then another horse appeared, and this one's a red one. First one was a white one. Now this is a red one. The rider was given a mighty sword and authority again to take peace from the earth. And there was war and slaughter everywhere. So this is like a spirit of war. The first one was a spirit of Antichrist. The second one is a spirit of war. And then it says the next one, when the Lamb broke the third seal, I heard the third living being say, come. And I looked up and saw a black horse. And on its rider was holding a pair of scales and in his hand. And I heard a voice from among them, the four living beings say, a loaf of wheat bread or three loaves of barley will cost a day's pay. Now I want you to think about this. What that's saying is, this horse is an economic crash. An economic crash so bad that a loaf of bread costs a day's pay. Just enough to eat for the day costs one day's pay. That's some expensive food. Okay? But it says, and don't waste the olive oil and wine. Now, I want to say, well, how are you saying this is a preterist view? When you read Josephus and some of the Bible scholars of the day, they would tell you that there were guys like Vespasian and Titus that had the spirit of Antichrist that was destroying Israel. So that, and they were, then God gave them authority to conquer. Then there was a war that broke out, a civil war in Israel, and there was famine that broke out as a result of the war in the Roman occupation, and the famine was so severe, it affected one quarter of the, it affected the Middle East, the entire Middle East region, and there were some Jewish people that were so hungry and starving, they actually broke into the temple and stole the oil and the wine. because they were so hungry they got everything they could. That actually happened just prior to AD 70. So it says, don't waste the olive oil and wine. When the lamb broke the fourth seal, I heard the fourth living being say, come. And I looked up and I saw a horse whose color was pale and green. The rider was named Death, and his companion was the grave. These two were given authority over one-fourth of the earth to kill with the sword and famine and disease and wild animals. And then the lamb broke the fifth seal, and I saw under the altar the souls of all who had been martyred for the word of God and for being faithful in their testimony. They shouted to the Lord and said, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us? Now, some people look at this as a futurist view, and it's going to happen in the tribulation, and it may. I'm going to talk about that view next week. But this view could have already happened in AD. All those things already happened in AD 70, or prior to AD 70. So you could, just depending on how you look at it, and there are scholars of the day to verify that up. Now, let's look at the next view, which this is the most common view. This is the futurist view. How many of you believe that just about everything in the book of Revelation is going to happen in the future? That's what the futurist view is. But except for the first three chapters, because the first three chapters, it talks about Jesus had a message for the churches of the day. So everything in the futurist viewpoint will happen in the future from Revelation 4 forward to the end. So with that in mind, here's one that I believe is a good example of that. And I know I'm going deep, and I know I'm doing it, but I have to lay a foundation so you'll understand. Are you with me? Don't lose me. Revelation 16, because remember I told you there's seven trumpets, seven seals, and seven bowls? The sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth bowl all have to do with this, what I believe hasn't happened yet, but is in the future. And here's what it says. The sixth angel poured out on his bowl the great Euphrates River, and it dried up so that kings from the east, many Bible scholars believe that's going to be China, could march their armies toward the west without hindrance. And I saw these evil spirits that looked like frogs leap from the mouths of the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. They are demonic spirits who work miracles and go out to the rulers of the world to gather them for battle against the Lord. How many of you are watching the news, or how many of you will be watching the news in the next couple weeks? You're going to see an attack on Christianity like you've never seen before because of what's happening right now with the Supreme Court judge is nominated, and she's taking a stand for Christianity, and she's about to get attacked. Now, I'm not going to get political here today, but I've seen, just as a pastor, just recently, more attacks coming against the church and against Christianity than I've ever seen before. Because I believe that the enemy, the devil, has unleashed spirits and are irritating and agitating people all around the world. And so the Bible says that comes to a culmination here, and it's a battle of all the evil and against the Christian world, against the Lord. And on that great judgment day of God, the Almighty, look, I will come unexpectedly as a thief. Blessed are all who are watching for me, who keep their clothing ready so they will not have to walk around naked or unashamed. That's a symbolic way of saying they stay pure. You know what? It doesn't mean you're perfect. You know the difference between perfect and pure? Pure is I'm covered by the blood of Jesus, and every time I make a mistake, I have the grace of God in my life, and praise God for that, because if I make a mistake, I can cry out to him and say, Lord, I am sorry, and he is faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. There are no perfect people. If you're here today looking for a perfect church, you're never going to find one until you get to heaven. Then that's where the perfect church is, because it'll be every nation, every tribe, every tongue, and we'll all be up there with a new body and new spirit. But anyway, walk around naked and ashamed, and the demonic spirits gathered all the rulers and their armies to a place with the Hebrew name Armageddon. I believe this is a futuristic view of the Battle of Armageddon that takes place at the end of the tribulation period. That's my belief. I think that's a great example of the futurist viewpoint. Okay, let's look at one more, and then I'm going to tie all this together. Okay, are you ready? Are you ready to tie it all together? You're going to say, Finally. Man, you've been going through all this scholarly stuff, and now it's put it all together. So a spiritual interpretation. Remember, there was a historical way. There was an AD 70 way, or preterist. There was a futurist way, and now there's a spiritual way. The spiritual look at the book of Revelation sees that Revelation is recurring themes that happen over and over, and they're spoken in symbolic language. Okay? Here's some examples of that. I have the first chapter basically carved out between Revelation 1:8 and a few verses to follow. Jesus said this, "I am the Alpha and Omega." You may not know the Greek alphabet, but that's the first letter and the last letter. And he says, in case you don't know the Greek alphabet, says the Lord, I'm the beginning and the end. Jesus, and it blows our mind that he always was, he always is, and he always will be. That's eternity. That's a mind-blowing thing that, well, wasn't there a beginning? It says, in the beginning, God. God was there before the beginning. So I am the one, here it is, who is present, who always was past, and who is still to come, the Almighty One. So there's a key in interpreting this, and I'll share that with you when we tie it together. Then the next verse says this, verse 12 through 16. When I turned to see, here's John in his vision, another vision, who was speaking to me, I saw seven golden lampstands. Imagine that, just lamps, or seven golden lampstands. And standing in the middle of this circle of seven lampstands was someone like the Son of Man. And we know it was Jesus. He's going to interpret this symbolic language here in just a second. He was wearing a long robe with a gold sash across his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were like flames of fire. There was an intensity, a passion for the bride in his eyes, a love like flames of fire. His feet were like polished bronze refined in the furnace. And his voice thundered like the mighty ocean waves. He held seven stars in his right hand. So you're picturing this and go, what does all this mean? And a two-edged sword, sharp two-edged sword, came from his mouth, which just means that's the Bible. Remember, the Bible says the word is like a two-edged sword, and I did a teaching on that, but it means authority and power are coming from the spoken words of Jesus and the spoken word of God. And so, and his face was like the sun in all its brilliance. And it says that this is the meaning. It says, in case you can't figure out this symbolic language, I'll explain it to you. The mystery of the seven stars you saw in the right hand, Jesus is talking now, in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Now, this is really cool to me, because in that day, there was Ephesus, Smyrna, Laodicea, Philadelphia, and these seven churches that were planted as thanks to the Apostle Paul, and he assigned pastors over all those churches. And so heaven also assigned angels or messages to those churches. And one day we'll do a study of the first three chapters of Revelation where we'll talk about each message. And to me, they represent seven different kinds of believers. But anyway, the seven lampstands are the seven churches. And so he's explaining, so here's the stars and the lampstands, and God's got a message. And what the cool thing is, what makes me think and wonder about this is there an angel assigned to LifeSpring Church? I bet there is. And a message to LifeSpring Church? And is it possible that a pastor can pray and seek God and fast and get a message from God and deliver it to LifeSpring Church, and it's a message directly sent from heaven? Man, I think that's cool, and I hope, and I pray all the time, God, don't let me misspeak. Let me share what you want me to share to the church. Amen? So, for whatever that's worth. So you're sitting here going, okay, so this is Jesus, and he's speaking to the churches of the day, and How am I supposed to interpret the book of Revelation? Well, there's a fifth way that I believe. And I know I said four views today. But I believe personally in kind of a hybrid mix. That sometimes the book of Revelation is futuristic. Sometimes it's in the past, historical. Sometimes it already happened by AD 70. And sometimes it's symbolic. And that's just my belief. You don't have to believe like I do. But I challenge you to research and ask God. God, share with me. And I challenge you to begin to read the book of Revelation and ask God to speak to your heart about He would have you interpret. And there's going to be, if you talk to your friends, you may find that one says, no, that passage in Revelation was more like the elephant trunk. And the other one says, no, that's more like the car trunk. No, that's more like a tree trunk. But it's how God reveals it to you. Are you with me? Are you with me? Now you have to, it has to line up with the Word of God. I don't know what's going on with this. It has to line up with the Word of God. So it can't contradict the Word of God. Like I've had some people tell me, well, you know, God spoke to me and He clearly said to leave my husband. And I'm like, God didn't clearly speak to you, and that was another voice. The Bible calls an angel of light, but He didn't speak to you to clearly leave your husband, because in His Word, God condones marriage. God blesses marriage. God always has a reward for those who stick it out.
Amen.
Amen. All right. As a lady sticking it out right now, bless God. No. We all have those testimonies. Thank the Lord. So I just want to pray for you right now. And I know this has been kind of a more of a theological perspective, but I think it's important to learn that. Amen. I think it's important to get a foundation, so in the next weeks you'll understand a little bit more as we go a little bit deeper. So, Lord, I just want to pray, and I pray that You speak to hearts right now. I pray that You speak to people right now, speak to their heart, speak to their spirit. And if there's anyone here that needs to make things right with You, I pray that that gets done in Jesus' name. Is there anyone here today, as our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, that would reflect and say, you know what, I need to straighten out my relationship, or I need to get back to my relationship with Jesus. I've kind of drifted off a little bit. It happens. People sometimes get drifted off or get distracted or see things in a different way. So if that's you here, just raise your hand this morning. Come on, make a commitment to God. Yes, yes, yes. I see those hands. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for lifting those hands. Now, let's just all pray this prayer together. Can we say, Father, I thank You for Your Son Jesus, who came to this earth with a gift of grace. And He gave us that grace, which are things that we don't deserve. And I ask You to forgive me for my sins, for my mistakes. And I thank You that Your Word says that if I ask You to forgive my sins, to forgive my mistakes, then You are faithful to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Jesus, I need You to be my Savior and my Lord. I commit to You in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, can we give God praise this morning? Amen. Listen, next week I'm going to share about those four horsemen in a different light. And I just hope this blessed you today. I know it was kind of a foundational message, but I had to share that with you. So next week's it'll make sense. But here's the bottom line. Why are we talking about the end times? Why are we studying this? Why are we doing any of this? Because there are people out there who are your neighbors, who you see at the bank, who you see at the grocery store, who are your friends that don't know Jesus. Families. And they're scared to death right now. Some of them won't even come out of their house. and they need to know the hope that's in Jesus Christ. And you can be one of those light bearers and go out there and share the hope of Jesus Christ with them. Amen. Hey, I'm going to turn the service over to Pastor Robert. He's got a few important announcements. Listen, we got a great week coming up at Life Spring Church. I can't wait to see some of you in small groups. Some of you, we're going to have a work day right out here. How many of you know it's about time we get a little bit bigger kids area and we construct a playland out there? Amen. Robert, tell us all about it.
All right. So we do have a lot going on here. But first, everybody take out your phones. Take out your phones. You got your phones out? Get your cameras up. And take a picture of this. I'm just kidding. Just kidding. Take a picture of that. It'll pull up your QR code. It'll pull up your this month's activities. It lets you know what's going on. And you can have it on your phone. It can be right there. A lot that's going on. So we have the Christianity 101. That's today after church. If you want to get to know God, get to know if you're a new believer and you want to know what's going on, you want to get deeper, that's a great thing. It's here right after church. If you have something going on, we have a lot going on. So Monday nights, if you're a man or a woman, raise your hand. There you go. All right, we got something for you. This Monday at 7 o'clock here at the church is the men's and women's group. You can come be a part. It is great. Men are doing the Maximize Manhood book. It is a great book, so come and be a part. I don't know what the women are doing. They won't let me in there. So please come be a part. If you're open on Wednesday, please come up here on Wednesday. If you're married, this is a marriage couple. It's Millennium Marriage. It is Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Come be a part. It is awesome. Friday night is for couples. It's a game night up here at the church. Please be a part. I love coming and being a part of Sunday morning service, but you will get to know people so much better if you come and do the small groups. The small groups are awesome. I know the thing says at my house, but it's going to be up here at the church. We kind of changed it up. We don't want to clean at our house, so just kidding. But we're going to be up here. It's going to be at the church. We're going to have a good time. Also, everybody say this Saturday. This Saturday, we're going to do a work day up here. They're going to put together the kids' stuff. They're going to put together all this playground. We're going to put a fence around it. Come be a part. It is at 10 o'clock here. If you show up at 7:30, nobody will be here. If you show up at 9:30, you will get a breakfast taco. So come be a part. Also, we got more stuff going on. So much stuff going on. If you are in the Finally Free, that is the people who no longer have kids at home, they are meeting at El Chico's today at 5 p.m. Yes. See Merv and Darlene, you come be a part. That is the Finally Free group. Also, everybody say next Sunday. Next Sunday is the baptism day. That is one of our wonderful, most amazing Sundays. Yes. If you have not been baptized and you have accepted Jesus, this is the next step. This is what you want to do. It talks about it so many times in the Bible that we need to be baptized. So come, be a part, be baptized, accept Jesus Christ by faith, and then take the next step and show your faith in being baptized. That's what we want to do. That's what we believe. All right, man, that's a lot to go through. Everybody get all that? You got it on your phones? So you don't have to ask me as soon as I step off, oh, what's going on? No, you got it on your phones, right? All right. Hey, there's also five ways to give. You can give in the buckets. You can give online. You can text. You can do so much. So many ways to give. There is no excuse not to give. I'm telling you, if you forget to give this morning, you can do it this afternoon. You can mail it in. You can text it in. You can go online. You can do it all. So many ways to do it. There you go. All right. Right in the middle. Let's do it. Hey, all right. Let's pray a prayer of blessing over you for this week. I want to see you be amazing this week and go in the name of the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come before you today. Lord, we say thank you. Thank you for allowing us to come here and be a part of this, Lord. Thank you for letting us serve you and worship you, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to give back to you and what you do for us, Lord God. We thank you. We pray a blessing over the gift and the giver today, Lord. We pray for this week that it'll be an amazing week this week, that we will have the opportunity to share you with someone today, Lord God, and the rest of this week. God, I thank you and I praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.
I'm captivated.